Well, hello and welcome to my big comfy couch, where I'm going to do the first sit-down video that I have done in, I don't know how long, guys. It's been a while since we've done an informative video. Like, sit-down, informative, capture your attention with my Zevia drinking kind of style vlog. Going over a common theme that I'm answering in my DMs, and in fact, I actually posted this particular physique update, and it kind of sparked all this attention around how I've been able to maintain my upper body physique while trying to grow my lower body. And just the changes that I've made in maintaining and trying to hone in on not growing anymore in my upper body so I could stay within the bikini division as an athlete. Plus, that's just the preferred look that I like on my physique. This particular physique showcased how I've been able to change my overall composition with holding the same amount of body weight almost, and the changes in what the musculature has presented itself based on my hard-earned efforts of 2019. All of 2019, I sought after not growing my upper body anymore. I didn't want to add on any more tissue there, but I wanted to completely annihilate my lower body physique and just grow as much tissue in all areas of my physique. So what this is not, is it's not a Fitspo creating a video telling you on how they got glutes, because guys, I've been seeking tissue in both my quads, hamstrings, and glutes. It's not all about the booty. I wanted just stacked legs overall. My dream is to actually have bigger legs than I do now, but I know that to stay within the bikini realm and to deal with what I would likely have to do in my kind of non-dieting physique, I would probably have to push the boundaries of that a little bit more, and I'm not certain if I actually personally want to go there, but I am so happy with what I have achieved, regardless of whether I end up stepping on stage in this quarantine, because I don't know how many weeks of dieting I've done. I don't know how many more weeks I will have to endure in order to step on stage. So regardless of that, I am just so happy with what I accomplished in 2019. It took this year for me to kind of see what all that meant for me. I do have my note because I definitely haven't done a sit-down informative video in so long that I felt like I needed notes for you guys. So I might have to stop, refer to my notes. You guys will bear with me here, but I wanted to give you guys as much information as possible. So when I was younger, when I first got into bodybuilding, all I wanted was arms, sculpted shoulders. That's like exactly what I sought after. And I feel like my training and how I preferred to train did favor that. I was able to predominantly get a pretty well-rounded upper body physique. I actually sought after this because as I started to lose weight, I noticed that when I gained it back, and if I didn't put on any density in my upper body, I actually ended up just getting arms back to where I was at, and I never really got to get my arms to stay visually fuller. So obviously, in order to create visual fullness, you have to have more tissue there. So I was able to achieve more tissue in my upper body over the course of, I would say, 5 or so years of my lifting career. Now, obviously, my genetic predisposition, my genetic potential, all of these factors vary differently and drastically from yours. So I do encourage you guys to just take this with information, with how you can apply it to your training protocols and to your training routine, but understand that if you replicate exactly what I've done, you are not me, I am not you, you do not have my genetic potential and makeup, I do not have yours. So you could actually supersede everything. It may not take you 7 years to build up the shoulders that I have built up. It may not take you 5 years to build up the glutes. Maybe you had glutes already. I did not. You know, everybody has their own predisposition, predetermined genetic potentials. That's not to say that you can't defy that by working really hard though, so keep that in mind. And so you guys aren't having to watch me talk at you this entire time for a long format video, you can enjoy background footage of an at-home workout in my garage gym. This is going to be footage from an anterior day focused on chest and delts. So I hope you guys enjoyed the workout footage going on in the background of me just chit-chatting at you. To reference what my previous shoulders and arms looked like, you guys can see some of these previous early competition days. This is probably from 2012 to 2014. I just had little arms. Like, that's just what I had. And so I definitely have improved over that in the course of the years. And I was like, if I could do that, then I sure as heck better be able to put some density on in my lower body. I just had to get smart about it. When I was inquiring what you guys wanted to know about the most frequently asked question was, do you take creatine? And I don't know why, but for some reason it was. So yes, I do take creatine. I think that has allowed me to build the tissue I have now? Over the course of 7 years, absolutely. But do I think that it made the vast difference and improvement in my lower body training? Absolutely not. I started taking creatine in 2012 consistently, 5 grams daily. That is the recommended dosage, most research-based dosage on creatine monohydrate. While I'm not a Fitspo telling you how you can get bigger glutes, I will be a Fitspo doing a shameless plug. I have been using creatine for many, many years. Before I lined up with Legion Athletics, I was just using a bulk supplements product unflavored. Then I lined up with Legion and they have Recharge, which is flavored. And I was like, oh my God, I can put this in my water and it can actually taste pretty damn good. I'm in. So strawberry lemonade's my favorite. One serving of this is actually exactly 5 grams of creatine monohydrate. So we're good to go. I've been taking that for 7 years. Do I think it's exactly why my lower half grew? No. Do I think over time and the saturation of my muscle tissue to improve training capacity and muscular endurance over time has improved because of creatine? Absolutely, but I do not think it's the sole reason why my lower body has improved. Just wanted to throw that out there. But I do agree that creatine, especially for females, that is one of the most researched products in the sports supplement industry, on us particularly. So you might want to start getting on board with creatine if you're not already there. All right, second thing was, did you decrease upper body frequency? And I did not. I've been training for the entire 2019 year. I trained upper body twice, lower body twice. I did not favor one over the other because I wanted appropriate recovery in both. My frequency of training upper body has been the exact same. I didn't replace an upper body training with a lower body training or vice versa. None of that happened. I just pulled back on training to failure in my upper body, and I strategically chose the particular movements that I wanted to train to failure with, or I wanted to strive for PRs in. That would have been any movements that had been related to my delt improvement, and that would have been my shoulder press, overhead presses, and chest presses and flies. So those are the two movements that I would typically put at the top of my workout, and I would utilize that time and space where I was less fatigued to really strive for higher RPEs, strive for PRs, strive for potential mechanical failure if I was under the support and help of a spot, or utilizing some sort of machine apparatus in a mechanical failure setting. So like a shoulder press machine or a chest press machine, where in which I was safely able to go to mechanical failure because I had the support stabilization of a machine rather than free barbell or free dumbbell work. So for example, if I had 5 movements in my day for upper body training, those first 2 movements would be the priority. And those would be the ones I would maybe overreach in just a little bit. All right, so that alludes to question number 2. Did you increase frequency of lower body training? And I absolutely did not. As I told you guys, I trained lower body twice a week. This allowed for recovery as well. If you are going to seek muscle tissue, you also have to seek appropriate and optimal recovery. That means not overtraining, not creating a lot of inflammation in the area that you're trying to seek actual visible tissue improvement in. Deloading also became an essential part of my focus. So if I wasn't recovering properly, I knew I needed to deload. And were my deloads structured necessarily? No, they were structured based on my feedback. Do I recommend you actually looking into deloading? Absolutely. Should you deload about every 4 to 6 weeks? Probably somewhere in there, yes. Depending on your training intensity, your training protocols, your whatever it is you're striving for, circumstances, whatnot, whether or not you're traveling, you know, all of those things factor in. So there's not an exact equation. It's a personal preference and a personal feedback on whether or not you should deload and when you should deload. If you're striving for growth, you have to strive for optimal recovery. That's just point blank. So be very, very cautious about increasing your frequency in hopes of seeking tissue growth. It's not always the appropriate answer, I promise you. And unfortunately, I feel that a lot of women will automatically increase frequency and they're not stepping back and taking a bigger scope at the picture and seeing that there's other factors in play that are causing your progress or your tissue growth to be less optimal. We'll cover some more of that as we move on. Okay, how did I approach training my lower body? I did seek progressive overload in almost every single movement of the day. I absolutely 100% sought progressive overload. So it's a little bit different from my upper body training. In my upper body, I sought it for 1 to 2 movements, and then I tried to kind of stabilize and keep my strength typically on an even keel, allowing enough tension to keep muscle tissue around, but not spark that much more growth. Now, with my lower body, I did the exact opposite. I sought progressive overload in every set if I could get it. Obviously, I would put weight on, see if I could get it, see if I couldn't. yes, sometimes I could, yes, sometimes I couldn't, but overall, I progressively overloaded over the course of an entire year in my lower half. I sought crazy amounts of mass in my leg press, squat, deadlift, RDL, leg extension, leg curl. Like, I just went after it. I did seek mechanical failure or higher RPEs for most closing sets of that particular movement. So when I was coming to the end of the sets in that particular movement, I did strive for a higher RPE, that 8 to 9 to 10 threshold. Now, if I was in a machine like a leg extension, leg curl, I sought after mechanical failure because again, I had the machine to support going to mechanical failure. I also worked with peak contraction holds or tempo control, meaning I focused on a lot of barbell pause squats. When I paused in the bottom of the hole, that's the most eccentric portion of the glute tissue. That's where it's going to be lengthened. I focused a lot on pause squats. I focused a lot on barbell hip thrust where I held the contraction pause at the top of the barbell hip thrust. I did all of those things to encourage my tissue to grow and to encourage that stress on that tissue to be adaptive. When you adapt the tissue to stress, it grows. It's great. And the last thing before I close out, I spent all of 2019 not dieting. I never once pulled down calories for any trip that I had, for anything on my to-do list, for any photo shoot, for anything. I never pulled my calories down. But what I also did was I focused on optimal digestion throughout that entire year in almost every food choice or every food decision that I made, with the exception of some diet flexibility here and there. Whenever I took a trip, I took that as a week of not tracking. I allowed my body, my mind, that time to recover, to recoup, to get out of that app, because I hate being within my FitnessPal every single day. It drives me nuts. I know it drives some of you nuts, but I know it's what I've got to do to accomplish my goal. However, I needed a couple of those weeks throughout the 2019 year to just kind of chill out and go ham. So I chilled out, went ham, got back right into it. But optimal digestion is something that a lot of people don't focus on the necessity for growing muscle tissue. So I chose to eat foods that digest and process well over foods that sometimes I would just prefer to eat. And so, yes, I was a little bit more intense in that way, sure, but overall I felt so much better. And when I ate to perform better, I performed better. And your digestive tract is like your second brain for a reason. If you're not digesting your food properly, that means you're likely not uptaking your nutrients properly. So again, food choices made a huge impact on me. I ate foods that offered me great digestive feedback. Potatoes, rice, cream of rice, less cruciferous vegetables, lots and lots of fruit. I don't know why fruit is such a bad thing. Like, eat fruit. It was a great way to get a large volume of carbohydrates in quickly. It was perfect, and I digested and processed it well, and it was so refreshing. I did not just choose to eat nothing but cereal and protein bars and, you know, all of this processed food just because I could and just because it could fit in my macros. Because whether I could eat it didn't equate to whether I could perform eating it. And I think that that's a big distinction with a lot of people, is just because you have it within your macros, if you're not growing and you want to grow, if you're eating to perform, then your performance will reflect whether or not your food is working to your advantage. And I think that those things aren't often connected in this whole not diet culture, trying to grow culture, trying to build tissue culture. There's all these mixed messages and mixed streamlines of information going on. We see somebody eating this glorious bowl of, you know, cereal and protein and halo top ice cream and all these things. And then we see a great amount of muscle tissue and we equate to eating that way. Well, maybe your digestive pathway doesn't work as well as this person's. And you have to take that in consideration. So for me personally, I have a sensitive digestive tract. I can't eat all those things and then perform well in the gym the next day. And I was starting to notice some of this feedback early on in my career. So when it came time to me not dieting for an entire year, I was like, if I want to feel good and eat this amount of food, I got to make these changes and I've got to be okay with it. And, you know, I was, because my goal meant more to me than momentary amount of food that I was going to consume or a momentary meal that I was going to consume. And any and all traveling that I did to enjoy outside of my meal plan gave me enough satisfaction to stay focused on my goal when I wasn't traveling. All right, guys, so that wraps up my video. going over how I grew, I'm just a little bit leaner, and therefore you're seeing a little bit more defined muscle tissue on me. All I've done is add a little bit more tissue to my frame. I have been unable to take a DEXA scan to actually see how much I changed. I know last competition season in 2018, I did do a DEXA scan. So as soon as this quarantine is over, I'm definitely seeking that to provide a little bit more information to kind of wrap this whole concept up and showcase how much muscle tissue I've actually been able to put on in a year. But I really have no proof of that other than visual progress pictures, updates. So we will go ahead and close with a physique update. Thank you guys so much for watching. Give me a thumbs up if you like this sit-down chat informational video. It helps me know that you like this style of content. Be sure to subscribe to my channel so you never miss a video from me. And I will see you guys in the next one. Bye-bye.
For my mama, when I finally make it, take all my vacations to Bahamas. Always celebrating. Ever since my birth, I was the bomb, and now I'm detonating. No, you can't relate. You just can't relate. Every day I wake up like a boss, and I be thanking Jesus. Fake is trying to get up in my circle. I don't really need them. We be saying we up next forever. Now we really mean it. We about that action, acting bad shit when you see us. Yeah, I'm passionate.